to a very special edition of Lifestyles and Art. I'm your narrator, Kimberly Tillman. And in a moment, we're going to take you back to a time not so long ago when the world witnessed the sculptures of the legendary Richmond Barthe.
A few years ago, I had a fascinating conversation with sculptor Richmond Barthe. We spoke at length about his life and work. And during the course of our conversation, many interesting facts and thoughts were expressed by this dynamic artist. I discovered that he was born in a town I had not previously heard of, Bay St. Louis, Mississippi. He also told me that he preferred to be called Barthe rather than Richmond because Richmond sounds rather formal, like an Englishman. Barthe sometimes says of himself that he is an old soul, and then launches into his belief in reincarnation. During an earlier life, he describes himself as having been an Egyptian artist who was stabbed in the back and murdered. An old soul, he says, brings to the new body those accumulated experiences and skills of earlier lives, and then with that already accumulated reservoir, in the new life, continues to improve on those earlier skills. Whether we believe in reincarnation or not, we are forced to marvel and wonder at Barthe's youthful appearance and his artistic talents.
Richmond Barthe was a man who endured and triumphed as he followed his own star, a star that led him to many parts of the world. Born on January 28, 1901, in Bay St. Louis, Mississippi, to Richmond Barthe and Marie Clementine Rubidoux, Barthe never knew his father, who died at the young age of 22, when Richmond was only 1 month old. At an early age, Richmond's mother gave him his favorite toys, marking pencils and paper. He was fascinated with shapes, especially those fancy old English letters that he saw hitting local newspapers. His talent sharpened, and at the age of 12, his work was shown at the county fair in Mississippi. A literary critic by the name of Lyle Saxon discovered Barthe's genius at the county fair and attempted to no avail to get Richmond registered into the New Orleans Art School. With racial prejudice being the reason he was denied, Barthe continued his art work. In 1924, Richmond Barthe was admitted to the Art Institute of Chicago with the aid of a Catholic priest. During his four-year stay, he pursued a career as a painter. In his last year at the Institute, Barthe's anatomy professor suggested he try modeling in clay to better understand the third dimension in his painting. Using two of his colleagues as models, he followed his teacher's advice and sculpted two heads. Instead of discarding the work, he entered them into what was known then as Negro History Week Exhibition, later Black History Month. He executed busts of artist Henry O. Tanner and Haitian General Toussaint Louverture, of which were held in Opportunity Magazine of Chicago in 1928. Barthe moved to New York in 1929, and during the next two decades, he would build such an awesome reputation that his work was praised by the New York press more than any other sculptor in the United States. His exhibitions and commissions were numerous. In only his first year in New York, he completed 35 sculptures. In exhibitions and galleries in New York, sculptures such as The African Dancer, Blackberry Woman, Comedian, and The Boxer were commonplace. Barthe, a Harlem resident, decided to move downtown New York for increased studio space, but received criticism for abandoning his people. Nothing was further from the truth, as he illustrated in his 8-foot frieze of green pastures titled The Wall of Jericho for the Harlem River Housing Project. Living downtown gave Mr. Barthe the opportunity to be in the company of show business stars, stars like Vincent Price and a host of other Broadway stars who left his work. One magazine columnist wrote these words about Barthe: Richmond Barthe is an artist of unusual powers. He has come to us at a time when we are sadly in need of real inspiration, of that spiritual food that heartens and strengthens in hopes that embodies the willingness to do the larger and truer things of life. There is a magic of earnestness in his work. There is a charm of unassertive measures of beauty which stamps the work of all true artists. Different from Rodin, apart from Epstein, his work somehow partakes of that realization of artistic aim which distinguishes the work of each of these masters. Superstars such as Edward G. Robinson, shown here with him, commissioned him for many private works. Though he did not feel his race determined what he sculpted, he did feel that it was an advantage for his rise to fame. His good looks, hard work, natural talent, and humble personality set him apart from more aggressive personalities in his field. As popular and as successful as Barthe was, the tense environment took its toll, and he found himself retreating to a quiet life in Jamaica, West Indies. He remained there for 20 years. Barthe again rose to enormous heights of success. His 8-foot statue of Haitian General Toussaint Louverture towers amid the country's State House lawn today. During the mid-60s, Jamaica turned ugly with violence, mostly from gangs, and Barthe moved once again. This time, it would be east to Switzerland, then Spain, and Italy before settling in Pasadena, California. Through his travels, Barthe left a legacy of his work spreading over 17 countries.
Dr. Samela Lewis, of whom most of this information about Barthe was provided, displayed some of his work last fall at her own Museum of African American Art inside the May Company in Los Angeles. We talked to Dolores Hudson, the museum's director.
We thought it was time. Dr. Samela Lewis, who curated the exhibit, felt that she wanted to bring an exhibition of Richmond Barthe's works here. She knew him personally. As a matter of fact, she's writing a book on him, which should be out, I imagine, the first of the year. And he had such talent, and his works are of such magnitude that we felt we wanted to share it with everybody. And so the board of directors of the museum, along with Dr. Lewis, decided that it was time to bring it to Los Angeles. The pieces that you see here are from the museum's permanent collection, and other pieces are from private collectors. Hopefully, when it closes, it will travel. We're not quite sure at this point, but we're hoping that it will travel throughout the country. I had the opportunity to see him once at an exhibition, which he and I both attended. I did not know him personally. I know people who did know him personally, and they describe him as a very, very unique person, someone I'm sure that I would have loved to have known personally, you know, had I had the opportunity. He left a rich legacy. To me, it's a legacy of richness. It's a legacy of that allows me to know who I am, where I came from, and what I can be or could be. This is why we open the museum to school children, people of all ages. And we're very happy that we do have busloads of youngsters who come in here to see the exhibit. And we give them tours. We have people who give them tours and explain the different pieces to them. They explain who the artists are, give them backgrounds on the lives of the artists. They should know everything about their history, because African American art is their history. It gives them an opportunity to find out who they are and where they came from. Definitely more, always. We'd like to have standing room only in here. We'd like for this place to be jam-packed all the time. And this is why it's accessible, it's easily accessible to the community here in the Baldwin Hills Crenshaw Plaza and, you know, housed in the May Company. We want people to come. We'd like to have lines out there, because we feel that what we have to give them, and what's here is so important for them to see and to know. So if you're out there listening, come on over.
While living in one of the Balearic Islands,
Richmond Barthe will often tell the story about this little bee. Every morning when Barthe would have his breakfast, this little bee would come visit with him and have breakfast with him. This amazing bee somehow knew the exact time Barthe would have breakfast and land on his favorite spot on Barthe's hand. One particular morning, a female companion came over to visit Barthe. She saw the bee on his hand, and out of fright, she shooed the bee away. And Barthe said, "No, don't shoo the bee away. He's my friend."
In fact, Barthe claims that on one day he was leaving the country, something landed on his cheek, and it felt like someone was kissing him goodbye. That someone happened to be the bee. Upon moving to Pasadena, Barthe's reputation was heightened when in April 1980, President Jimmy Carter gave Barthe and a fellow artist, Charles White, special recognition awards.
This was a typical conversation between Richmond Barthe and fellow sculptor Elizabeth Catlett, who now resides in Mexico.
Barthe, your figures are so beautiful. Do you use models for them?
I never use models. I can't afford models. I once called a modeling agency and asked what they would charge for models. Guess what they said?
What?
$27 an hour. Now, you know I couldn't afford a model. I couldn't in 1929, and I don't now.
I don't use models either. Sometimes if I do a head of somebody, I might use a model.
Did you know that blacks did not even like my work when I left New York in 1940?
Well, the piece I like tremendously is The African Dancer.
I believe that people who hate others are those who hate themselves. If you love yourself, you love others.
On March 7th, 1989, Richmond Barthe died here in Pasadena. Before he died, the city dedicated this drive to him where he once lived. Richmond Barthe had a fascination with his previous life. And if you believe as he did, he is still alive and living among us. Could it be possible that Richmond Barthe is a part of Little Kyle's dream?